Welcome, geniuses. I'm Genie, your best buddy for A-levels. In this channel, we'll bring you to explore the secret formula behind success. She's Malaysian. Well, like all our previous guests, she grew up in the harsh and grueling conditions of Kuching, Sarawak, a backwater city, which is relatively advanced, and we do not live on tree houses. She studied in a Chinese primary school and a Malay secondary school, which means she's from two completely different worlds. Kind of like Superman and Krypton. She's going to Oxford University to study material science. Here to share her application experience with us today, the one and the only Myra, ladies and gentlemen. The video will be separated into three parts: personal statement, entrance test and interview, mistakes, and personal advice. Feel free to check the timestamps in the description below to skip around to your desired content. So, geniuses, let's get started.
Thanks, Genie. Hi everyone, I'm Myra and I'll be your guest speaker for this episode.
Hi Myra, what materials are needed to write a good material science personal statement?
Now, there are tons of ways to structure your personal statement, but this is how I did mine. So I had 6 paragraphs, the first one talking about what initially sparked my interest in material science. The second one was about an interesting material I read about in an article. The third one included the 2 books that I read for my personal statement. The fourth one was basically talking about my A-level subjects and how they relate to my course. The 5th and 6th paragraphs were mostly about my academic and extracurricular activities and achievements. My advice would be to begin the research and drafting of your personal statement early so that you'll have enough time to take out any unnecessary content and fine-tune your personal statement. On the topic of research, make sure you read lots and lots of articles and books relating to your subject so that you have plenty of material to work with when you're writing. Never include books you haven't read in your personal statement because that will come back and haunt you in the interview stage. Next, no personal statement will be perfect on your first draft. You should definitely send it to a few people you trust for proofreading. For example, you can have an English teacher grammar check your personal statement, as well as a subject teacher double check the more subject-specific information, especially your research. You could also get an alumni or student from the university you applied to read through your personal statement because they've gone through the process themselves and probably have a decent grasp of what the uni is looking for. Last but not least, keep your personal statement personal. Now, I know this sounds really, really obvious, but I actually struggled with this issue myself. Initially, my personal statement was a little too general, and I realized this would be a shortcoming in the application process because the goal here is to stand out from the thousands of people applying for the exact same spot as you are. I ended up describing a childhood activity of mine, which was making sculptures out of clay. I talked about how this might have seemed like fun and games at the time, but upon reflection, the mechanism behind clay sculpturing was actually an integral part of human civilization. So yeah, I'd advise you to look at your own personal experiences and ask yourself, okay, how does this activity relate to my course, and what skills did I pick up that would help me in studying my subject? If you've done any experiments on your own, definitely try and incorporate those into your personal statement as well. The unis are looking for people who are passionate about their subject, and they want to see that you're actively seeking out more knowledge and you want to know more. It doesn't necessarily have to be some huge achievement or huge project. I read 2 books specifically for my personal statement. The first one being Stuff Matters by Mark Meyer Downing, and the second one is Physics of the Future by Michio Kaku. Now, Stuff Matters is a highly entertaining introduction into the world of materials, and I think it's an absolute must-read for all material science students. It's very easy to get through, and it reads very much like a novel. However, the thing about this book is that it's been used a lot, so I would avoid using it in your personal statement if possible. Physics of the Future is a very insightful read. It talks about how the author expects the future to look like, making predictions recommendations based on current technology. As for further recommendations, you can check out J.E. Gordon and his books titled The New Science of Strong Materials as well as Structures. His books deal with the properties of materials in much more detail compared to Stuff Matters.
What entrance test did you have to take for material science at Oxford?
I was only required to do one entrance test for Oxford's material science course, which is the Physics Aptitude Test, PAT. This test is divided into two sections. There's a physics section as well as a math section, and it's a mix of objective and subjective questions.
How did you go about preparing for something like that? I mean, it sounds pretty daunting just hearing about it.
For me, the easiest way to prepare for PAT was to do the past years. You can find the PAT past years on the Oxford website. I also had to read ahead in physics because I hadn't covered some of the topics in college. For questions that I couldn't do or didn't understand, I would ask my physics teacher for help. After I finished all the PAT past years that were available online, I went on to do some questions from the British Physics Olympiad. There are also some useful links and resources on the Oxford website to help with PAT preparation, but mostly I just relied on the PAT past years because they really help you to familiarize with the format of the test.
Well, it looks like you got that part down pat. Get it? P-A-T? It's a pun. Now, there seems to be this notion that the interview is often the scariest stage. How'd your interview go?
I had two interviews, one at St. Anne's College and the other one at St. Cat's. I would say they went relatively well. There weren't questions that were impossible to answer, especially because you have tons of help from the tutors.
So, definitely difficult, but not impossible. Sounds like a job for Tom Cruise, if you ask me. I joke. So, anyway, how did you prepare for your interview?
One of the biggest tips I received was to learn to think out loud. Basically, articulate your thoughts in front of the tutors. They want to see how you think and how you tackle a particularly tough question. So don't be worried if you're stuck, because the questions are designed to make you think. They don't have any simple or straightforward answers. Try to voice out your thoughts, and the tutors will help guide you from there. If you stay silent, the tutors won't know what's wrong and won't know how to help. I prepared for this by basically just talking to myself, and there's absolutely no shame in doing that. You could also get a few friends to ask you questions and just speak in front of them. Besides that, it really, really helps to do mock interviews. If you're a Malaysian student applying for Oxford University, there's a club called the Oxford University Malaysia Club. You can Google OUMC to find their website. They organize a mentorship program whereby you can arrange for mock interviews with Malaysian students currently studying at Oxford, as well as ask them any questions you might have. This gave me the exposure I needed, and one of the questions given to me by my mentor was also quite similar to a question I received in the actual interview. For my course and for engineering courses, there are usually graph sketching questions, so I did a lot of practice on those. I'd recommend watching YouTubers who've documented their interview experiences online, as well as reading articles written by other applicants. I also read this book titled The Ultimate Oxbridge Interview Guide. Now, the questions in this book weren't exactly the form of questions I received in the actual interview, but they were really interesting, and I would say this is a pretty good starting point. Before the interview, make sure you know your personal statement from top to bottom. Read up on everything you've mentioned, and I mean every single thing. Reread any articles or books you've used, and just know your stuff. You should also have a solid understanding of your A-level subjects, and most of the interview questions you'll be able to answer or deduce the answer to using knowledge you already have. It also won't hurt to do extra research. For example, you can look up recent articles so that you're up to date with advancements in your field. Be prepared to answer questions like why Oxford, why this college, and why study in the UK. These are usually just icebreaker questions, but it's good to have answers in mind so that you don't get flustered.
Now, there's two types of interviews, right? The face-to-face interview in person and the face-to-screen-to-face version through Skype. What's the difference between flying in for your interview and just having it online?
I personally was fortunate enough to be able to fly to Oxford for my interviews. I told myself that even if I couldn't get in, I'd at least have spent a night in Oxford, and that in itself was already a dream come true. There's a few things you should consider if you're deciding between flying to Oxford and having an online interview. The first one being the number of interviews you get. So if you're doing it online, you will only have one session, whereas if you fly there, you will have two. The first one being at the college you applied for, and the second one being at a randomly selected college. My colleges were St. Anne's and St. Cat's respectively. So technically speaking, you'll have two chances if you choose to fly to Oxford. So there's a slight room for error. The second thing to consider is nervousness and anxiety. So if you're doing an on-site interview, you would first have to adjust to the new climate, completely new surroundings and new circumstances. So it was my first time in the UK when I was doing my interviews, and it was also winter. So I ended up being quite sick for most of the trip. But luckily, on the day of my interview, I was feeling okay. On the other hand, if you're doing an online interview, you'd get to do so in an environment that you're already comfortable with.
Is it true that chances of getting in are higher if you fly?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. Please fasten your seatbelts and secure your tray tables.
In my experience, a lot of people got in through online interviews as well. Two of my friends who got in did online interviews. It's definitely true that you get two tries if you choose to fly to Oxford, but I don't think doing it online affects your chances all that much. But a plus point in flying to Oxford would definitely be the college accommodations. You get to stay in the college you applied for, and all the meals are provided for you. The college I applied for, St. Anne's, had amazing food.
Sometimes we're caught up in the moment and we make mistakes. In hindsight, do you think there were any mistakes or hiccups that you made in your application process? And if so, what would you have done differently?
I think a mistake I made was I mentioned a material in the interview which I wasn't fully prepared to answer questions about. So do extensive research on anything you wish to mention, especially things you included in your personal statement. Also, during the end of my second interview, the tutors asked me if I had any questions for them, which, nervous as I was, I didn't have any. So it's a good idea to prepare questions beforehand so that you can avoid any awkward situations.
Is there anything you wish you had known before you applied?
Interviews aren't as scary as you think they are, because the tutors are usually very nice people. There's tons of guidance and you can learn a lot from your interviewers. You definitely won't leave empty-handed. I was lucky enough to be able to hold a zirconium tube, which the tutor explained is used in nuclear reactors.
You're not radioactive now, are you? Because I left my hazmat suit at home. Before you go, Myra, say, if someone slept for the entirety of this video, until this point of course, what would be your main takeaway? And I don't mean Kung Pao chicken.
Work hard, practice, 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 and believe in yourselves. Don't be intimidated by Oxbridge, because you never know how good you are if you never even try. I hope I've been able to help, if even a little bit, in your uni application process, and I wish you all the best.
Thanks, Myra. I'm sure applicants everywhere really appreciate it.
Thanks again, Genie. It was a pleasure to be here.
That's all for today's video. If you're interested in more genuine sharing by other geniuses, please subscribe to our channel and don't forget to turn on the notification bell. Ding dong. Genie, we'll see you in our next adventure. Bye-bye.